right, turn to the book of James towards the end of the Bible. This morning we're going to pick it up. Our last study, we made it through James chapter 1, verse 1. We're going to triple that today. We're going to go through James chapter 1, verse 2 through 4. Moving right along. Let's pray once more. You know, if the Holy Spirit does not speak God's word to our heart, it just doesn't get done, you know. I could just be up here making a lot of noise. That's all I do is make a lot of noise. But you know what? When the Holy Spirit gets involved, it teaches you God's word, then it's something. Okay, so let's ask him one more time. Lord, we pray this morning that you would reveal to us from your word what we need to hear from you. And Lord, I would just be out of the way because I have nothing to offer, Lord. So speak to us this morning in the book of James. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, James, as we looked at in verse 1 there, let's all read it to you again. James, a bondservant of God, of the Lord Jesus Christ, which we looked at that 2 weeks ago before you went to the retreat. We looked at that, you know, Lord Jesus Christ is not just his first, middle, and last name, but we looked at what it meant, okay? Lord, he is Lord, and it's Jesus, he is the Messiah, Christ. So we looked at that. He's writing this book to the 12 tribes who are dispersed abroad. It's his greeting. So he's writing to the 12 tribes that have been scattered around. Okay? And what he does now, he's going to jump right into the subject matter. This is a book that is the rubber meets the road. He doesn't beat around the bush. He's going to jump right into it, and he's going to hit a subject that it really is not a lot of fun. Things that ruin our lives. The trials of life. He's just going to jump right in. He doesn't waste any time. So what does he do? He says in verse 2, he says, consider it all joy, my brethren, when you encounter various trials, knowing that the testing of your faith produces endurance. And let endurance have a perfect result so that you may be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. So he jumps right in and says, count it all joy. Yeah, this is fun that I'm going through this hard thing in my life. No, come on, James, what are you talking about here? Fun. You know what? Start your trial. He's saying, start your trial, your problem, your tribulation, your temptation. Start it off like this. Count it all joy. Instead of woe is me, count it all joy. Joy because God is doing something through this trial and this problem in your life. You can know that. You can bank on it. He's doing something in your life. That's the joy about it. Not that it's fun. You know what? When I have a physical ailment, that's a trial. That's a tribulation. I don't count it. I don't go, hey, this is fun. Give me more. I'm a big baby, man. I should probably tell you that. Santa's telling you, you're a big baby. I don't like pain. You know, God, you know, when I was paralyzed, I'm telling you, you know, I'm a big baby. Now I can put your pastor differently, right? I didn't cry, though. I wasn't crying, man. Only a little bit. But I didn't cry because I was paralyzed. I cried because I saw the love of Christ visiting me. That's where it pierced me from. Joy of the love I saw of Jesus while I was paralyzed. It was great. It was a terribly wonderful trial. How does that sound? Yeah. You know, and God's in control. God is in control. You can have joy because God is in control. Now, so control, what do you mean by that, Mr. Jim? Well, you know what? Nothing comes in your life or my life unless it's sifted through God. It's got to go through him first. You know, a lot of people don't like that, and I understand why. When something terrible happens to one of your children or you or a loved one, you know, it's like, God, why did you let that happen? He did. But he let it happen for a reason. He knows best. That's what faith comes in. We have to accept those things. It's hard. He knows it's hard. But you know, we have the perfect example. We'll look at it once again this morning in the book of Job. To show us the example of how God is in control. In Job chapter 1, I'm going to read through this time the New King James Version, not my American Standard. So the Bible law might be worded a little bit differently. Okay? Job chapter 1, verse 8. You know, Satan was going to and fro on the earth. You know, he has access right now to go around the world and check it out. He comes sit next to you, Miss Patricia, and go, hey, 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 you know, and try to just go on with it. And, you know, he has access. But remember this, Satan can only be at one place at a time. So, you know, for me, the people always say, oh, I know Satan's here and all that. Well, that's great, man. He's not following me, he's following you. You know, he's always following there's certain people that it seems like they're always talking about Satan. He's always there bothering them. I'm thinking, well, great, keep him busy. If you like him around, you know. But you know, he's got a lot of buddies. A lot of demons and stuff. But as far as only one place at a time, now Jesus is everywhere. God is everywhere. Same only one time. So since then the Lord said to Satan, have you considered my servant Job? That there is none like him on the earth, a blameless, an upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. I mean, Job was a good man. He was a man that you would look up to. Wow, what a man of God. And then in verse 9 says, so Satan answered the Lord and said, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him, around his household, and around all that he has on every side? You have blessed the work of his hands, and his possessions have increased in the land. But now, stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. You know, God had blessed Job. He obviously was saying to him, you blessed him, man. You have a hedge around him. You've protected him. You've given him everything he needs. He's got everything. Just touch him and watch him curse you to your face. And so then God says in verse 11, and the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power, only do not lay a hand on his person. So Satan went out from the presence of the Lord. You see that? Okay. Sometimes you go, that sounds pretty mean of God, doesn't it? Wait a minute. God, why did all that happen? You know, God knows best. But he allows it. He'll only allow in your life what you what he can handle through you, I would probably say. He's in control of what comes into our lives. And he will only allow those things that come into our lives that happen. They work out good for us. As a matter of fact, it says in Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good to those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. So it's going to work out for good. And I can tell you, of my almost 40 years of walking with the Lord, everything's worked out for good. No matter how bad it was, no matter how much I didn't like it, it's worked out for good in this man's life and my life. I'm a living testimony of that, okay? I can go down the line and give you example after example. I'm just going to tell you. So you have some of you have heard some of my examples. You know, in Isaiah 61:3, the Lord says this. He says, to console those who mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes. He gives us beauty for ashes. He trades your sin and gives us his righteousness. The oil of joy for mourning. The garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. That we may be called trees of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. You know, it'll work out in your life. It's going to be beautiful in your life, and God is going to be glorified in your life through these things that happen. And he's going to turn it around. He's going to make good stuff out of it. So, in this verse that we look at here in verse 2, it says, when you encounter various trials, the King James Version says temptations. You know, the word means to prove, to be tested. It's talking about to prove yourself through these trials when they happen. You know, in verse 3, it talks about the testing of our faith. The testing of our faith produces endurance, okay? Endurance. In the Greek word there, it means patience. It produces patience into you. The Greek word is hupomone. If I say it correctly, we should call it hupomene. Hupomone. I'm not a Greek scholar, but it means this. Hang in there. Hupomene. Hang in there, man. Just hang in there. It's going to work out. Have patience. Don't run. Just keep on, keep on. When I was a kid, we'd say, just keep on trucking, man. Keep on trucking. Keep on moving. Just keep on going. You know, what happens is, in your faith is built. You get patience through this. You know, it only happens by the testing of your faith, those things. Really, listen, have you ever worked out? Most of us have times to work out. Mr. Nathan, our intern here, he's working out right now. Every day he comes home and goes, man, I'm going to be slim, all this stuff I'm doing. And he went down to the soccer field yesterday, kicked a little football with the boys. And they came back, yeah, I'm trimming up. Like you really need some, right? So, yeah, you think mine, I'll think you're trim. But you know, you work out, you know those times you work out, especially when you haven't done it for a while, and you work out, and after you work out, you're like, I'm dying, man. You can't move, your muscles hurt. You know, I go see Miss Patricia, and she makes it worse, you know. It beats me up. Then it gets better. But you know, you work out, it's hard, you think you're killing yourself. And what does it do? It produces muscles. In the end, you get muscles. And so that's what it's talking about here. You get this endurance. You grow. You get stronger. You'll have patience as your faith is being tested. Now, it takes commitment. You know, I do talk a lot about commitment. You know, the Lord wants us to be committed. It takes commitment to Him. You know, in Matthew 16:24, it talks about the kind of commitment that we should have. When Jesus said to His disciples in Matthew 16:24-26, He says, if anyone desires to come after me, let him deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me. For whoever desires to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what profit is it to a man if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Or what will a man give in exchange for his soul? Hey, if we desire to follow after Jesus, we will deny ourselves. We will deny the self-life. We will put Jesus first. That's what it means. What would Jesus do? You know, for years now, what would Jesus do? They give out little bracelets. What would Jesus do? Necklaces. What would Jesus do? What would Jesus do? And that's a good thing. What would Jesus do? Sometimes, you know, I say that I don't really want to because I know what He would do. I don't really want to do that, Lord. What would Jesus do? We say the word sometimes, but is our heart really there? Do we really mean it? You know, through my many years of evangelism and traveling that Sam and I have done, we've seen a lot of people in our concerts come to the Lord and give their life to the Lord. And then when we go back or we're hanging out or whatever, we don't see them in churches. The churches haven't grown. I mean, what kind of commitment did they make? An emotional commitment, probably. They're not denying yourself. You don't see them in churches. You know, that's not that kind of commitment that the Lord wants of us. He wants us to deny ourselves. You know, and when you really give your life to the Lord, you'll follow Him. You start reading the Word. You'll get in fellowship. You'll pray. You do those things. Deny yourself. Commitment. You say, I love you, Lord. What we do is, do we do His commandments? If you love me, you will obey me. That's what He says. So the Lord, He puts us and allows us to go through these trials, through these tests, so that we can prove, it proves our love to Him. It really does. When we hang in there, and it proves to Him that we love Him. You know, I mean, look at Abraham, what Abraham went through. Abraham was promised a son, and the son didn't come, and years passed, and he got old. His wife was older than any one of us in this room, I think. And she, and then what happens? He gets the child. Isaac, laughed, it was so old, they had left. Ho, 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 ho. Like I tell you, because Anna and I had a child, now we wouldn't laugh, we'd hang out with your kids, okay? That's a scary thought. But Abraham, he's over there so happy. And they have the baby and the child. And then what happens? A little trial comes along. A little testing comes along. God says, Abraham, I want you to take your son, your only son, and take him up in the place that I will show you and sacrifice him to me. Come on, man. Is that the God you want to follow? That's like, I mean, that. Come on. Most of us would grab the kid and go, other direction. doesn't even sound right. You know? You tell people out in the world, they go, see, what kind of a God is that? Why would you follow a God like that? Well, you know what? We're going to see why. Do what Abraham do? Come on, son, let's go, man. And walk up to that hill. Walked up to that hill to sacrifice him because he loved God more than he loved his son. Priorities were right in his life. He loved God. Well, as the story goes, he gets up there on the mountain. On the way up, you know, at one point, you know, Isaac says, hey, we got the sacrifice, man. We got the fire, we got the wood. But where's the sacrifice, Dad? God will provide himself the sacrifice. And he goes up there, you know the story, he takes the knife, it's ready to put it through his son. He must have been crushed. But he believes God's promises, that the promise was going to come through that son. And he's going to have to raise him up, then some miracle is going to happen or something. So he obeyed God, and God stopped him. You showed me that you love me. You showed me that you obeyed me. Wow. That takes faith. You know what? I don't know if I can do that. But with the grace of God, yes. Boy. He was tested, and he came fine. He came through with flying colors. 1 Peter 1:7 says, the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it is tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ. You know what? Understand that through your trials, God is making you stronger, and God is glorified through you. When I was paralyzed, you know, when I made it through my trial, and I came out the other side, God was glorified through me. And all I can say, through that incredible trial I went through, all I can say is glory to God, it was him the whole way. I was just kind of along for the ride. I don't know what's going on. I'm just going along. You know, what else are you going to do? Can't get up and run. You know, Paul, you wonder sometimes, what is going on here, Lord? What is going on? One time, in 2 Corinthians 12:13, he was going through something. He had something going on in his life that was just getting him down. He was going through an intense, heavy trial in his life. It says in 2 Corinthians 12:8 through 10, it says, concerning this thing that he was going through, I pleaded with the Lord 3 times that it might depart from me. I mean, he pleaded. Lord, take it away. Well, I pray that. Oh, Lord, please heal me. I want to walk. I want to feed myself. You know, I understand. And the Lord said to him, my grace is sufficient for you. Wow. I remember that. I remember when I was in the hospital. And for a couple of days, there was a couple of days that everywhere I turned around, all I heard was, my grace is sufficient for you. Yeah. I don't care. You don't want to walk. I don't want to hear that. I mean, I'm going to admit this anyway. But turn on the radio, the Christian station, the message. My grace is sufficient for you. And then she turned on the TV to a Christian program. My grace is sufficient. She would open the mail in the car and be, my grace is sufficient. Somebody called her. God said, my grace. I mean, it was just like, didn't want to hear it. I wasn't quite like Paul at that time. But you know what? His grace was sufficient for me. I wasn't stressed out, really. I mean, I wasn't crying. I mean, I was okay. I just didn't like it. But his grace was there. But that's how I got through it. I've seen people go through some trials. And go, I don't understand how I can go through that. I couldn't go through that. I don't have that grace for that trial. When you're going through the trial, his grace is sufficient for you in that trial. It's a different kind of grace that I have. Then he went on to say, therefore, Paul says, most gladly I would rather boast in my infirmities. I'll boast in my trials. I'll boast in what's wrong with me, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. See, Paul got it. God is self, I am weak, he is strong, makes me strong. And that's what happens. And I literally seen it through my trial when I was paralyzed. I saw the strength of the Lord blow people away when he came to visit us in the hospital. It's totally blow them away. Come to minister to us and walk away. Almost light shining in their faces. Because I was weak, I was strong. Because I could look at them in the face, I had more peace than they did, usually, when people would visit me. They were going through things in their life, they would be going through things in life where they could thought they could do something about those things, and they'd be stressed over those things, and this, and all this kind of stuff. And here I was, I'm going through a trial, I'm paralyzed, I can't do anything about it, so I just surrendered it, and I was filled with peace and joy. And they were like, well, how can you be that way? Jesus, His grace is sufficient. But I am weak, He is strong. Okay? And it continues there in verse 4. He says, and let endurance have its perfect result so that you be perfect and complete, lacking in nothing. It will make you into who God wants you to be. See, He is developing you into someone special. You're already special to Him. He's developing you into what He wants you to be. We have to understand that. It's not perfect, like without sin. I'm not talking about that. But perfectly usable by Him. Formed us so that He can use us. So in the trial, you can say, I wonder what God is doing here. God's going to do something through this. I wonder how it's going to work out. But God's in it. He's going to get us through it. And it's always that way. It's just coming to that place in your mind, in your heart, that place of rest, that place of peace. Hey, Paul and Silas knew it, didn't they? I mean, they're out sharing Jesus with people. People are getting healed and things. They get busted for doing good things. Unjustly thrown in jail, and they go in jail and have the first Christian concert that we know about. The first one is recorded in the Bible, sitting in jail, praising God and singing. They were beat. They had to have wounds on them. They had to hurt. They weren't sitting there going, oh man, they go, oh my back. Oh, that was like, oh, I hurt. No, they just praising God. What happened? The chains fell off and the doors opened. Didn't even run. They didn't run. Wow. Philippians 1:6 says, being confident of this very thing, that He who has begun a good work in you will complete it until the day of Jesus Christ. He's working on you, man. You're a work. We are a work in progress. I would like to say that, I was at least 10% there, but I'm more like, I'm not even a percent there. I don't. The closer I, the longer I know who God is, the more I realize I'm a creep. I'm nothing. I'm overwhelmed sometimes of how much He loves me. He forgives me of my sin, my attitudes I still get. Oh man, sometimes I hate myself, my attitudes, I hate my sin. And He still loves me and forgives me. I can't do nothing to share Jesus with you because I'm forgiven a lot. And He uses you in every trial, no matter how big or how small. Romans 5:3-5 says, and not that only, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance. Perseverance. Character. And character, hope. And hope does not disappoint because the love of God is poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who is given to us. We can glory in our trials. We can have joy. Count it all joy in our trials. That doesn't mean, you're having a trial and you should look like this. Joy. Joy is different. It's not just that fuzzy feeling. It's just peace. Joy. Peace. Further here in the book of James, which we're going to get to, in the next week or so, James 1:12 says, bless is the man who endures temptation. For when he has been approved, he will receive the crown of life which the Lord has promised to those who love Him. Wow. As you endure the trial and you get through it, when you've been approved, when you made it through with the other side, man, you're going to receive the crown of life. You're going to get in eternity. And we're going to meet Jesus. And He's going to be passing out the rewards banquet, judgment seat of Christ. And He's passed on rewards. And here's going to be this crown. Man, you made it through. I'm giving it to you. you love Jesus, he's going to give you that crown. You're going to have it all through eternity.
Wow.
And it will be worth it. The trials you're going through, are going to go through, or have been through, you know what? When you're there, you might not think it's worth it now, you will then. He says in Romans 8:18, Paul speaking against us, for I consider the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. Hey, listen one more time. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory that shall be revealed in us. You know, it's not even going to be, whatever the worst trial you go through is going to be nothing when you're there in glory. You're in glory. It's going to, how it's going to bless you there in glory. In every trial that you go through, when you come through, he's going to reward you. He's going to bless you there. Wow. So don't get worn out. Stand. Keep his promises in your heart, the things of the word that he has for you. Remember, he will work it out, and he will work it through you, and he will reward you more than you can imagine. So what do? Hang in there. Start off, okay, Lord, I'm going to count it all joy. I know, Lord, somehow you're going to work this out. I promise. And that's the place you got to start. And you can pray about it. You don't have to pray. Give me more trials. I don't pray for that or patience. I get them whether I like it or not. You know, Chuck Smith, Pastor Chuck Smith, he used to say this about trials. He would say, it will make you bitter or it will make you better. And trials of mine. It will make you bitter or it will make you better. Observe that in people who go through things. Either they're getting better or they're getting better. So hang in there. You know what? And for us, this morning, we're going to have, you know, once again, have a fresh start. Like we do the first Sunday of every month here, we like to take the elements of communion.